Hello friends, in this video we are going to revise the subject strength of material. This video include the basic formulas of this subject and the basic concepts which are necessary to be memorized for the sake of competitive purpose. So let's start the strength of material. What is the material? Material are of two type, either rigid or flexible. Rigid material is which doesn't undergo change in the geometry, size, shape or both when subjected to a force or moment, okay, which does not undergo any change in geometry, okay, that is the rigid material. Flexible material is vice versa. The stress are of two types, either normal stress or shear stress. Normal stress is axial stress, bearing stress, bending stress. We will see all these in this subject. Shear stress is direct and indirect. Stress is a second order tensor quantity. How we represent tensor quantity? By this matrix. Here we are having the direct stresses sigma xx, sigma yy, sigma zz, that is in all these three directions, and the shear stress on these places like tau xy, tau xz, it is tau yz, and similarly here. Now six stress elements are required to define condition of a stress. What are these six elements? Sigma xx, sigma yy, sigma zz, tau xy, tau xz, and tau yz. These shear stresses have their complementary stress on the lower triangle. Now design of member, we always apply a factor of safety. Factor of safety is yield stress upon working stress. Okay, working stress is actual stress and yield stress is the stress at which the deformation occurs. Now the margin of safety is factor of safety minus 1. Like we are having factor of safety as 1.5, then we are having margin of safety as 0.5. okay, now normal strain is normally delta deformation upon length, or d delta by dl. It is measured by extensometer. Modulus of elasticity is E equals to sigma by E, that is stress upon strain. Bulk modulus of elasticity is longitudinal stress upon volumetric strain. And shearing modulus of elasticity is shearing stress upon shearing strain. Next is our stress strain curve for mild steel, low carbon steel. This graph is obtained for the tensile test, and for the compression we have the negative curve here. Now this graph from point O, that is starting point, to A, we are having this linear graph up to B. So here we are having A as proportional limit, B as elastic limit, C as the upper yield point, D lower yield point, E is the start of the strain hardening, F is the ultimate stress point, and G is the point of stress at the failure of the material. Okay, now there are few region here, like this is proportional region, or this is the up to this proportional limit. The Hooke's law is applicable in this region. After this point D, that is lower yield point, we are having the plastic region up to point E. From E to F, we are having strain hardening region, and F to G, we are having the necking region. Stress strain curve for other materials means the first one was for mild steel. For other materials we have a stress strain curve like this. This first graph is for quenched or tapered alloy steel. This one, the stress value lower than this is for high strength low alloy steel. For carbon steel we are having this graph, and the lower graph is for pure iron. Now as carbon content increases, then the ductility decreases in the materials, and the ultimate strength of steel will increase. Now in these tests, in the tension test, brittle material fails at 90 degree and ductile material fails at 45 degree. This is the angle made in the bar or the tube like this. If brittle material fails, it will fail like this, okay, this kind of failure, and ductile material will fail like this. In the case of tension test, in torsion test, just the reverse of it. Now properties of the material, these are the few important topics which we have to memorize for our competitive purpose of examination. Now, plasticity. Plasticity is the property by which material undergoes inelastic strain beyond strain at elastic limit. Okay, beyond strain at elastic limit. Okay, so property by which material undergoes inelastic strain means the elastic property is lost. The ductility is property of the material by which it can undergo tension or bending without fraction. We must have seen another definition that a material can be drawn into wires. Okay, so this is the property of material as ductility. Now it is measured by tension testing and bend test. Next is the malleability. Malleability is the ability of the material to be deformed or spread in different direction by compression force. Okay, like this is the material, and when we apply the compression force on it, then it will deform like this. Okay, on the surface. So this is the property malleability. Example is the rolling, pressing, hammering action. All these are example of malleability. Now the copper is a good malleable material. Okay, copper is good malleable material. Annealing is used to restore ductility and malleability to work hardened material after cold working. Okay, once work hardened material, the work hardening property is reached for the material, it loses its ductility and malleability property. So to restore it, we use the process of annealing. In annealing, material is heated to crystallization temperature and then cooled at room temperature. Okay, next is our creep. Creep is the gradual increase in the plastic strain with time at constant load. Okay, it is due to dead load only. Gradual increase in plastic strain. Let's see the graph of stress and time for creep. This is the initial elastic strain at zero time. As the time passes or time elapses, this strain increases due to the dead load. Okay, it reaches up to this point and moves like this. If we remove the load somewhere here, like at point E, if we remove the dead load what we have applied, then this elastic recovery will occur. Okay, it occur very rapidly, and then the strain in the body that is remaining is called the permanent plastic strain. Okay, this is the graph for creep. Creep depends upon temperature, stress level, time, type of loading, that is static or dynamic loading. Now moderate creep is good for concrete, and it relieves some tensile stress that might otherwise lead to cracking. Okay, in few cases it is helpful also. Now relaxation of steel. Decrease in the stress in steel as result of creep under prolonged strain. Decrease in the stress in the steel. Okay, if strain is prolonged for some time, then some stress is released. This is the graph. We can see here stress versus time. As soon as the stress is applied, okay, with time the stress value increases, but it reaches at that point when the stress starts decreasing with time. Okay, and very small value of decrement can be observed here. Now fatigue. Fatigue is the deterioration of the material under repeated cycle of stress or strain resulting progressive cracking. Like we are applying same load again and again, we are removing this load, then applying, then removing. Okay, this process will lead to the fatigue or lead to the fatigue failure. Okay, so let's see here the graph. Number of cycle of loading causing fatigue failure versus endurance limit for ferrous material. Okay, this is the graph up to the endurance limit, and for non-ferrous material this graph is obtained between stress and the cycle of number of cycle of loading. Okay, so below this limit the material will fail. Okay, let's see what is the endurance limit here. Endurance limit is stress limit below which even large number of the stress cycle cannot produce fatigue failure. Okay, endurance limit is half of ultimate strength. Let's see what endurance limit was here. Endurance limit was this limit below which if large number of cycle are applied, then also the failure will not take place. Okay, Next topic is the resilience. Resilience is the ability of the material to absorb energy when it is deformed elastically and upon unloading have this energy recovered. Okay, this is the ability of the material. Whenever some load is applied, then the material absorbs the energy. Okay, then when you remove this load, then this energy is released. Okay, so this energy is recovered. So with increase in the resilience, we can obtain the better spring action. Now, modulus of resilience is area under stress strain curve within elastic limit. You can see here, this is the stress strain curve. Okay, and up to the elastic limit, like this point, up to this point, this area under this curve is called modulus of resilience, sigma y square upon 2e. Next is the toughness. Toughness is the ability to absorb mechanical energy up to failure. Okay, modulus of toughness is strain energy stored up to fracture upon volume of the material. Toughness is desirable against impact loading. Mild steel is more tougher than cast iron. Okay, toughness is the material's property to absorb the impact loading. Okay, it can withstand the impact loading like this. Now, hardness. Hardness is the ability to resist scratch or abrasion. Okay, scratch or abrasion, it is measured by non-destructive indentation test. Now, the approximate stress strain curve, it is this curve is for elastoplastic material. You can see here that this graph is linear up to a certain point and then it is constant. Okay, once the plastic limit is elastic limit has reached. Okay, this is the elastoplastic with strain hardening, then this graph will increase after the elastic limit. Okay, this stress can increase after elastic limit. Now, ideal fluid at zero stress only, just the application of stress, the whole of the fluid start deforming. Okay, so this will be, the graph will be like this. Ideal rigid, it will never deform. Okay, no strain will be seen here, so the graph will be like this. Whatever stress you increase, there will be no deformation. Okay, rigid plastic is at a certain value of sigma, the whole of the deformation takes place. Okay, the deformation of the bar, we are having delta as PL upon A. So here the delta value is gamma L square upon 2E. Gamma is the unit weight of material of this bar. Okay, L is its length, E is the modulus of elasticity. So delta becomes gamma L square upon 2E. Now delta can also be written like WL upon 2AE. W is the total weight of this bar, A is the area of cross section, E is the modulus of elasticity and L is the length. This is half of the load due to load equal to weight. Now the circular cross section with tapered bar, delta will be 4PL upon pi D1 D2E. D1 is dia at first end, D2 is dia at second end, P is the force applied, L is its length. Okay, square cross section tapered bar, we are having formula as PL upon ABE. A is dimension at this point, at one point, and B is dimension at another point. With temperature change, delta value equal to L alpha delta T, where alpha is the coefficient of thermal expansion and delta T is the change in temperature, L is the original length of the bar. Now Poisson's ratio, mu equal to minus Ez upon Es, that is lateral strain upon longitudinal strain. And the strain in one direction can be written like this, sigma x upon E. Sigma x is in the direction, like we are having a three-dimensional material like this. If okay, and let this direction is x, this direction is y, and this direction is z. Okay, then this sigma x, that is in this direction, sigma x upon E, we have to determine Ex in this direction, that is strain in direction of x, equal to sigma x upon E minus mu sigma y upon E minus mu sigma z upon E. Now similarly, we can write for Ey and Ez also. Now Ev is equal to Ex plus Ey plus Ez, that is volumetric strain equals to sum of longitudinal strains. Now Ev becomes sigma x plus sigma y plus sigma z upon E 1 minus 2 mu by putting the values of Ex in this expression, Ex, Ey and Ez in this expression. Now, value of mu lies between 0 and 0.5 always. There is a relation between E and different other modulus, like between modulus of elasticity and bulk modulus of elasticity. We have equal to 3k1 minus 2 mu. Between modulus of elasticity and shearing modulus or modulus of rigidity, we are having 2n 1 plus mu equal to 9kn upon 3k plus n, and mu, that is Poisson's ratio, equal to 3k minus 2g upon 6k plus 2g. Here k is the bulk modulus and g, that is modulus of rigidity, g or n having the same value. Now SFT or BMD in this chapter, this is purely chapter of practice, so I'm just telling you in brief what is there in this chapter. Rate of change of shear force with distance is the loading. Okay, if you want to obtain the loading, we can obtain it from rate of change of shear force, and with rate of change of bending we obtain the value of shear force. So point of counterflexure is where bending moment changes sign, and point of inflection is when deflected shape changes the curvature. Okay, that is if this is the real beam and this is the deflected beam like this, if it goes like this, then these points are point of counterflexure. Now shear span is zone where shear force is constant. Now Maxwell reciprocal theorem, this is the first case. If we are having a cantilever beam, W is the load applied at the mid span and then W is the load applied at the end, then the deformation produced in first case at this end and deformation produced at second case at mid span will be equal to each other, sigma d is equal to sigma cd. Similarly, in case of moment applied at this point and at the end, and theta is obtained at end and at the mid span, then these theta will be equal. The third case is when unit load is applied at the end and theta is obtained at the mid span, or moment of one unit is applied at the center and theta is applied at delta obtained at the end, then this theta cd equals to delta cd. Next is method of determining this theta and delta at a point. There are different methods to determine the value of theta and deflection. EI is called flexural rigidity. First method is double integration method, d square v upon dx square equal to m upon EI, and d theta by dx equal to m upon a. M is the moment at any point like this from any end at x. Okay, if we are having some load here, then the moment obtained here is m. Moment area method is another method where theta equal to area of m upon EI diagram and delta equal to area into centroid. We will take the sum of area into centroid, then we will get the value of deflection. Now this method is used to determine theta and delta due to bending only. It is useful particularly for the beams which is subjected to series of concentrated loads or having segment with different moment of inertia. Next is the conjugate beam method, where shear force equal to integration of W into dx and theta equal to integration of m upon EI into dx. We can write it down like this also, integration of W dx into dx. This is m, that is bending moment, and deflection will be double integration of m upon EI dx into dx. Now slope at any point in the real beam will become shear at that point in the conjugate beam, and deflection at any point in the real beam become bending moment at that point in the conjugate beam. Now the energy method is external work done equal to internal energy stored. The delta value can be written like this, m into m dx upon EI. M is the moment due to unit load, m is the actual moment, dx upon EI. Okay, this is the internal work done equal to external work done equal to internal energy stored. Next is the Castigliano theorem. Delta equals to del u upon del pi, or theta equals to del u upon del m. Okay, this is the moment, this is the force p applied at the point where we have to obtain the delta or theta. Okay, in beams and frames, delta equals to this is the modified Castigliano theorem, m del m upon del p into dx upon ei, or theta equal to 0 to L integration m del m upon del m dash dx upon ei. M dash is moment applied at the or assumed at the point where we have to find out the theta. Okay, for sagging we are having positive value and for hogging we are having negative value of the moment. This Castigliano theorem is applicable to the at the constant temperature for unyielding support and for linear elastic material response only. The fixed end with sinking support, we have to memorize some values here like this. If this support sink delta, okay, then the value of moment will become 6 EI delta upon L square. Okay, this will be anti-clockwise moment and there will be clockwise moment. Now fixed beam with rotational slip, like for this value delta, okay, this theta value is the angle of the slip. Okay, like first support was like this, and if it rotate like this by angle theta, okay, now the value of moment at this MB, this at the end of the rotation will be 4 EI theta upon L, and at another end will be 2 EI theta by L. Next topic is stress strain transformation. Well, this is the material, okay, like this, and this is the plane in x direction, y direction. If it is rotated with angle theta, okay, or then this x dash and y dash, okay, we have to determine stress in x dash and y dash direction by using this formula. Sigma x dash equal to sigma x plus sigma y by 2, sigma x minus sigma y by 2 cos 2 theta plus tau xy sin 2 theta. Sigma y dash equal to sigma x plus sigma y by 2 minus sigma x minus sigma y by 2 cos 2 theta minus tau xy sin 2 theta. Tau x dash y dash equal to minus of sigma x minus sigma y by 2 sin 2 theta plus tau xy cos 2 theta. Now we have to memorize one thing here, that sigma x plus sigma y is equals to sigma x dash plus sigma y dash. That is, total stress cannot be changed. Okay, now principal stress and maximum strain, the formula is sigma x maximum or minimum equals to sigma x plus sigma y by 2 plus minus under root sigma x minus sigma y by 2 whole square plus tau xy square. Okay, now tau max, that is shear stress maximum value, will be sigma x max minus sigma minimum upon 2, sigma max minus sigma minimum upon 2, or we can write it down like this also, sigma x minus sigma y by 2 whole square plus tau xy whole square. Now tan 2 theta s, that is this angle in the Mohr circle, is equals to minus of sigma x minus sigma y upon 2 xy. Okay, this is the Mohr circle here. Tension will be positive, compression will be negative. Mohr circle for it is like this. Sigma x we can write here, sigma y, if both are in tension, then this circle will be obtained. And we are having this tau xy as the shear. This is the maximum principal shear. This is the minimum principal shear. This is the maximum shear stress. Okay, and this is tau max. Next topic is theories of failure. There are different theories of failure used for the materials to determine the stress up to which the material is safe. Okay, the maximum principal stress theory is the first theory, that is Rankine or Lamy's theory, where sigma, that is stress, should be less than Fy upon factor of safety. Fy is the yield stress for the material upon factor of safety. For no failure, maximum principal stress should be less than yield stress under uniaxial loading. This Fy is the stress under yield stress under uniaxial loading. Now this theory, first theory, that is principal stress theory, is applicable to the brittle material under tension. It is not applicable for ductile material and not suitable for shear case, pure shear case. Now maximum principal strain theory or Saint-Vincent theory, sigma 1 minus mu, sigma 2 plus sigma 3, that is this is the stress in other direction than the first direction. Mu is the Poisson's ratio. This sigma 1 minus mu, sigma 2 plus sigma 3 should be less than Fy upon factor of safety. This is satisfactory for the brittle material, but overestimates the elastic strength of ductile material. It is not applicable for hydrostatic condition and not suitable for shear case, that is pure shear. Now maximum shear stress theory, maximum of sigma max minus sigma minimum upon 2 modulus of this term, or sigma max by 2, sigma minimum by 2, this should always be less than half of Fy upon factor of safety. Okay, these are the values of shear stress obtained. Now this is applicable to ductile material. Okay, those theories were not applicable to ductile material, but maximum shear stress theory is applicable to ductile material. This maximum principal strain theory was the worst theory or unusable theory. We cannot use this theory in our practice. Maximum shear stress theory is very much applicable. It is applicable to ductile material. More conservative design of design out of other theories of failure. Now it is not suitable for hydrostatic loading. Next is our maximum strain energy theory or Beltrami-Haack theory. For design, we put this formula: sigma 1 square plus sigma 2 square plus sigma 3 plus minus 2 mu sigma 1 sigma 2 sigma 2 sigma 3 plus sigma 3 sigma 1 should always be less than Fy upon factor of safety 2 whole square. Okay, for 2D we can remove the term sigma 3. So sigma 1 square plus sigma 2 square minus 2 mu sigma 1 sigma 2. Okay, so this should be always be less than Fy upon factor of safety 2 whole square. Now this theory is applicable to ductile material, okay, and this is not suitable for brittle material. If it is not suitable for brittle material, it will not be suitable for pure shear also. Maximum shear strain energy theory, this is most valuable theory in our syllabus. This is also called a distortion energy theory. Here we write the value of distortion energy, which should be less than the distortion energy obtained by yield stress for uniaxial loading. Now 1 upon 12g sigma 1 minus sigma 2 whole square plus sigma 2 minus sigma 3 whole square sigma 3 minus sigma 1 whole square, this should always be less than 1 upon 6g Fy upon factor of safety to whole square. Now this is applicable to ductile material and applicable to pure shear cases. That is why this theory is most applicable. Now we have to note one point here, that all the theories of failure give the similar result under uniaxial loading. Next topic in our syllabus is bending stresses in beam. For pure bending analysis using Flexure formula, we put this formula: m upon I equal to F by y equal to E by R. M is the bending moment, I is the moment of inertia, F is the stress at the point of consideration, Y is the height of point from neutral axis up to the point of consideration. Now E is the modulus of elasticity and R is the radius of curvature. Now MOR, moment of resistance, will become sigma permissible into Z, that is section modulus, and MOR of I section is greater than MOR of rectangular section. That is why we use I section in our beams. Now section modulus Z equals to I by Y. Section modulus values for different section, like this: for rectangular section is BH square by 6, for circular is pi d cube by 32, for triangular section we are having value of Z equal to BH square upon 24. Next topic is shear stress in the beam. Shear stress at the level of Y from the neutral axis equal to VA Y bar upon IB. V is the shear force applied. A is the area of section above Y. And Y bar is the distance from neutral axis to the centroid of this section. Okay. And I is the moment of inertia about neutral axis. And B is the width of the rectangular section or some other section. Now for rectangular, tau value, that is shear stress, equal to 6V upon BD cube, D square by 4 minus Y square. Tau max is at Y equals to 0, that is tau max equal to 3V upon 2BD equal to 3 by 2 tau average. Now shear force per unit length equal to shear force, shear flow, this is equal to VA Y bar upon I. Okay. Now torsion in the circular shaft. We have the formula of torsion here, the torsional formula: T by J equal to tau by R equal to G theta by L. This is the shaft, we can see here like this. This is the torque applied here. Now the direction of torque can be given by right hand thumb rule like this. Okay, this is the direction of torque here. Okay, at this point we are having torque in the clockwise direction, so this will be like this. Okay, direction of torque will be like this. So in this formula we are having T as the value of torque, J is the polar moment of inertia, tau is the shear stress, R is the radius of this cross section, G is the modulus of rigidity, theta is the angle of twist, and L is the length of this shaft. Now shaft connection. In the series connection, we are having the sum of theta here, like this, first, second, third. These are different portions, and we are getting the value of sum of theta here, like theta AB equal to theta 1 plus theta 2 plus theta 3 plus theta 4. In the parallel connection, we are having sum of torque, that is T equal to T1 plus T2, like this. If this is the first material, this is the second material, then T1 is for first and T2 is for second, then this T equal to T1 plus T2, and what we equate here is the value of theta. Theta is same for both first and second material. Now torsional strain energy U equal to T phi by 2, it is work done by the torque. Okay, phi is the angle of twist and T is the torque applied. Now U can be written like this, 0 to L integration, that is T square dx upon 2gj, or T square L upon 2gj after integration. Now strain energy density, that is strain energy per unit volume, equal to half of tau into R. Okay, and gj is the torsional rigidity, gj by L is torsional stiffness. Power transmitted by shaft is equal to torque into angular velocity in radian per second. Next topic in our syllabus is column. Column is the structural member under compression. The column length is L, cross section dimension as D or B. Okay, if L upon D or B is less than 3, then that is called pedestal. If this value lies between 3 and 12, then that is short column. And if this value lies becomes greater than 12, then that is called long column. The first theory in the column is the Euler's theory for long column, P equal to N square pi square EI upon L square, or we can write it down like this, pi square EI upon L effective square. And we must know different values of L effective. Now critical buckling load, that is critical buckling stress, PCR equal to pi square E upon lambda square, where value of lambda, the slenderness ratio, equal to L effective upon R minimum. R minimum is under root I minimum upon area of cross section. Now value of L effective for different cases like this, for one end pin and another end is fixed, then L effective equal to L upon root 2, or we put this value like 0.8 L. For fixed case at both ends, L effective equal to L by 2 or 0.65 L. And for case of fixed at one end and free at another end, then L effective equals to 2 L. Both ends are pinned, then L effective equal to L. Here we are having some assumption in the Euler's theory. This is valid for long column only. EI, that is flexural rigidity, is uniform. Material is isotropic. Load is purely axial. Axis of the column is perfectly straight when unloaded. Next formula is the Rankine formula. It is valid for both long and short column. P equal to FCA upon 1 plus A lambda square. This A is the Rankine constant, whose value is FC upon pi square E. Okay, FC is the critical stress. Okay, A is the area of cross section. Lambda is the slenderness ratio. We can write another formula of Rankine like this, 1 upon P. We have to determine the value of P. Then 1 upon P equals to 1 upon P plus 1 upon PC. PC is the crushing load and P is the Euler's load, which we have obtained in the last case. Okay, the last topic in the syllabus of SOM is spring. Spring is an elastic device, typically a helical material coil, that can be pressed or pulled but returns to its former shape when released. Okay, it returns to its original shape when the force or the pull or pressing is released. Okay, it is used to exert constant tension or absorb moment. Now if the helix angle, that is this angle, this is less than 10 degree, then it is closed coil, and if the helix angle is greater than 10 degree, then that is open coil. The proof load is the greatest load that spring can carry without getting permanently distorted. Closed coil helical spring, in this case the value of shear stress in the inner portion, like this portion, is equals to 16 PR upon pi d cube 1 plus d upon 4R. Sigma outer equal to 16 PR upon pi d cube 1 minus d upon 4R. Let's see the value, let's see the term here. R equal to, R is the radius of helix, N is the number of turns, D is the dia of the wire, and G is the shear modulus or modulus of rigidity. Now strain energy stored in the spring, the formula will become 32 P square R cube N upon G D raised to the power 4. Axial deflection delta is equals to 64 P R cube upon N upon G D raised to the power 4. Stiffness P equals to K delta, K is equals to P upon delta. Then this value of K will become G D raised to the power 4 upon 64 R cube N. And the value of proof load will become pi D cube upon 16 R into Fs max. Okay. Here we are finishing with the strength of material subject. If you are having any query, you can write down in the comment section or mail me at windsofchange2020@gmail.com. Thank you.